Hey, everyone. Today, I'd like to speak with you about a tiny adjustment you can make that will transform both your life and ministry. Let's talk about that. Back in a moment. If you've done any kind of ministry in any context for any amount of time, and even if you haven't done ministry, I think that you understand this word. It is the word betrayal. Every Christian can expect, in a sense, to be betrayed at one time or another in their life. One of the things that makes it most difficult in ministry is to be betrayed by people that you once put your faith and trust in. Now, we sing the song when we're usually, most people have sung this song at some time in their Christian experience, to be like Jesus. All I ask is to be like him. Well, what we didn't realize is that was a prayer to God. And what we've often said when we're consecrating ourselves to God is, Lord, I want to be more like Jesus. Well, to be more like Jesus, you'd have to be betrayed, wouldn't you? Because Jesus himself was betrayed. And again, if you've been in ministry like I have for over four decades, you've experienced betrayal, not once, not twice, but probably more times than you can recall. Betrayal happens when, again, someone who you put your trust in or faith in or a friend or someone that you put your weight on or gave responsibility to, then turns around and does something really ugly. Perhaps they say something behind your back or a number of things behind your back. Perhaps they say things about you that are not true. Perhaps they leave the church and then say, again, things that are not true about why they left the church. Maybe they represent you in a certain way. I can tell you from my own personal experience that I had a betrayal a number of years ago where I was identified as an adulterer, even though that had never happened. I was identified as someone who had stole money from the church, even though I wasn't a signatory on the checkbook. So that was interesting. I've had a number of occasions where people have made accusations against me, and in almost every occasion, God has communicated to me, I don't want you to fight back. That was really hard because as somebody who was pretty well-versed in the English language, mostly because of my preaching through the years, I have a reasonably good ability to answer back verbally. And in many occasions, God would say, I don't want you to speak, much like Jesus before Pilate, who did not speak until the Father told him what to say. But what he said was not his own defense, but more as an explanation for Pilate's benefit than his own. So all of us will experience betrayal. And if you are someone who is worth anything in the kingdom of God, you have been betrayed. But that's not what I want to speak to you about today. Betrayal is not the tiny thing that I mentioned just earlier. What I want to mention to you is how you deal with betrayal. As a pastor, I have to guess that you've preached on the subject of forgiveness more than once, and you have encouraged people to let go of people that have done them wrong, betrayed them, hurt them. And I think we all have been in times when we've had to forgive people that we didn't want to forgive. That's part of developing our character in Christ. It's part of following Christ, is forgiving those who have done wrong things against us. But if you'll permit me, I'd like to go just a little further. There was a family that really did some, I would say, dirty things against our church and against our leadership. He is someone who had some influence in our church at one time. And he said and did some things that were really underhanded, eventually leaving the church with his family and then continuing to say things that were unkind. And it took a certain amount of forgiveness on my part just to let them go. And I truly forgave them. And I think that many of you can honestly say you've forgiven people who have hurt you or done wrong against you. But as I was considering scripture one morning, I believe the Holy Spirit began to enlighten me that forgiveness is not fully what he's after. What he's really after is something even deeper. I began to look at what Jesus did at the cross when he said, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. And then I began to think of the context of that. Here's Jesus on the cross, and he is saying, Father, forgive them. Who? Those that had put him on the cross, those who had lied about him, those who had slandered him, those who had come against him over 3 years of ministry, those who had thwarted every single sermon that he ever preached, every person that he ever healed, they were there to oppose him and come against him. They were, you might say, basically the devil's tools against his ministry. And here he was on the cross saying, "Father, forgive them." But let me put it in a different context. And I believe this is follows through with scripture. He was saying, "Father, have compassion on them. They know not what they do." And that kind of changes the idea of forgiveness a little bit for you, doesn't it? Have compassion on those who have hurt you. You know, I've been in ministry, as I mentioned earlier, quite a few decades. And one of the things I've seen throughout the years is I've seen the children of pastors. Many times, children of pastors don't go on to serve the Lord in any meaningful way. Or if they do, it's usually in a nominal way. In fact, I see a lot of pastors' kids that, frankly, don't want anything to do with Christ, and oftentimes will spend a life that is going the opposite direction of what their parents taught them. And it's a heartbreak to parents, and it's a heartbreak to pastors. But I want to share something with you that I've discovered when I've counseled with pastors and with pastors' kids. Oftentimes, pastors' kids don't forsake the things of God because they hate their parents. Actually, it's the opposite. They usually forsake the things of God because of what they see the church do to their parents. And then the response that their parents have towards those church people that did the wrong to them. Let me just clarify a little bit. Oftentimes we, as pastors, publicly forgive people. And even in our conversations with people, we speak about forgiveness. We preach about forgiveness. We talk about forgiveness. We have a public persona of forgiving those who have hurt us. But then behind closed doors, among husband and wife, in the household, among the kids, people's names are brought up, families that have done things that are wrong. They become points of discussion. And sometimes what's happening is the children are watching and they're listening to their parents and they're listening to whether forgiveness is actually real or not. And oftentimes what they're discovering is that even though publicly their parents are forgiving people and letting them go, privately, the discussions continue at home and the anger and the bitterness and, you know, that person this and that person that. And it doesn't sound like they've really forgiven them. I know that this is hitting a little close to home and I'm sorry about that, but let me just get to the point. I believe that what the Lord was saying to me is I want you to have compassion on those that have hurt you. And this, see, that changes the narrative a little bit. I was driving by this particular house of one of the people that had done this to me. And as I was driving by, the Lord really, I believe, brought it to my attention. And I just said, "Lord, have compassion on them. Bless them today." And isn't that what Paul said to the Romans? He said, "Bless them that curse you. Bless and curse not." Bless actually means to speak well of. In other words, to have compassion towards. Now, I want to make a distinction. I don't believe that God has called us to take boundaries down. Sometimes when people do things against us, we need to erect walls of protection. I'm not of those who believe you just forgive people and let them continue to do wrong against you. That doesn't make any sense whatsoever. We are permitted, and I think it just makes common sense, to put boundaries up when people have done things against us so that we don't keep getting hurt by that person or attacked by that person. We need to put boundaries up, walls up, the protection against what they'll do to us in the future. That's okay. And you have the right to put boundaries up and to leave them there however you feel is appropriate for you and your family. However, we can still have compassion for that person. There was someone who, again, another person I'm thinking of that really did some really underhanded things against me, against my family, against our ministry. One of the things that God impressed me to do with respect to these folks that had done this wrong to us is he asked me to do what scripture says, bless them that curse you and speak well of them. And in this case, pray for them that despitefully use you. Jesus said, pray for them that despitefully use you. That just doesn't seem to be the thing that we normally do. We're kind of willing to let them go and basically not speak wrong of them or maybe come to a place of where we're even keel with them. But to get to that place where we bless them or have compassion on them, well, that's another story. And what I began to do, and I have done this in the past, but I began to do, I just say, Lord, bless them and help them. And here's the worst part. God actually did bless them. I mean, we pray that prayer, but we really don't want to see them blessed. You want to see them helped. But you know, that is the nature of God. God blesses people, even the ones that do wrong against us. And this is the way, oftentimes, that he leads them to repentance. A number of years ago, there was a pastor that I was very good friends with, but in the course of our conversation, in the course of our relationship together, it became obvious to me that he was doing some things that were really ungodly. And I began to confront him privately about those things because he couldn't do that and remain in the ministry. But he didn't want to listen to what I said. And in fact, he not only didn't listen, but he actually started saying things about me that I was attacking him and trying to undermine his ministry and trying to steal his ministry, which I had no interest in, by the way. And he really brought up a bad reputation against me, even though I was only just trying to help him. And this whole dynamic of blessing came into play, where began to bless the man, began to speak blessing over him and say, Lord, I can't help this man anymore. He's defriended me. And back in the days before Facebook, he's kind of cut me off from him. But it was interesting to watch his life because from that point on, God began to bless him in amazing ways, just blessed him and blessed him and blessed him, blessed him financially, blessed his church. His church grew. All kinds of good things happened to him. And it was a little disconcerting because it was sort of like, well, Lord, he continues to do these things that are wrong, and yet you're blessing him. But see, the goodness of God leads people to repentance. And within that context, people will either recognize that God is being good to them and then humble themselves and repent of their sins, or they will take that blessing to validate their wrongdoing and go the opposite direction. Unfortunately, in this particular situation, the latter was true. He didn't recognize and he didn't humble himself before God, and unfortunately experienced an untimely death that was really just sad. And only moments before he died, he called me in privately to tell me that he repented of his sins and he asked me to forgive him. And I'm thankful. I was glad to be able to do that. But so much was lost because he didn't respond to the goodness of God. I'm saying all this to say, when we're talking about making a monumental change in your ministry in a tiny way, but a monumental change, that a lot of good things begin to happen when you ask God to have compassion on those that have hurt you. It really changes the narrative from forgiving, which almost seems like a neutral position, to Lord, have compassion on them, bless them. By all means, keep the boundaries up to the degree that that's appropriate for you. But saying, Lord, bless them, even though they've said bad things against me, even though they've done bad things against me, I ask you to bless them and bring them to repentance, bring them to a place of usefulness in the kingdom of God. That not only changes them, but more importantly, it changes you, because then you are fully released from any unforgiveness or anything that connects you to that person. In fact, when you begin to express compassion towards them and love towards them, even on a private way, what begins to happen in your own heart is there's no longer anything that Satan can come in and try to get a foothold in your life. And your own children, if you're in that age where you've got growing children in your family, they begin to see, this is what Dad does to those who hurt him. He has compassion towards them. And it shows them what Jesus looks like. And they're more likely to follow Christ seeing that example than they are listening to you bitterly complain about what people have done against you. Once again, I've seen this over and over again. A lot of pastors' kids that go away from God do so because they see the church as a place that has hurt their parents and they don't want to see that happen in their own lives. So they see the church as the enemy, but they don't see the church as their enemy only because of the church. They see it because of the way their parents respond to that. So be careful. What is the little adage say, be careful little eyes what you see, be careful little ears what they hear. You know, we've got to be really careful that our own children are not hearing from us something different at home than what we're preaching from the pulpit. Well, I hope this has been of some benefit to you. I really do want to see your ministry prosper and be blessed. And I believe that that tiny little thing is to begin to have compassion on those that have done you wrong. That takes the love of Jesus, that takes prayer, that takes supernatural working of God in your heart. But I know that if you'll take that step and say, Lord, I don't have that compassion for that person. I'd like to bless them. What Bob Mumford used to say, yes, Lord, bless them with a brick. That's not really what God has in mind. He's not looking for you to say bless them so that they get hurt. but that you bless them and actually want to see them prosper for the kingdom of God's sake. That's a whole different level of forgiveness. Well, before we go, as you know, I always end each podcast with a quote, especially for you. And this one is from Frederick William Robertson, who said, "We win by tenderness. We conquer by forgiveness." I want to encourage you to think about somebody that has really hurt you in recent times and ask the Lord not only to bless them, but to have compassion on them in these days ahead. It'll change their lives for sure, but it'll change your life even more. God bless you. I invite you to join us at ministerstoolbox.com for additional resources, and may the Lord help you in your ministry this week. Until next time.
Hey, before you go, can you please leave me a comment, like, and subscribe? I would greatly appreciate it.